Yeah, as you mentioned, I'm Thomas Fremen. I'm at Columbia University in the clinical psychology program and studying under Dr. Miller, who's doing a universal spirituality project. So the question that, I hope this will load correctly. This might take a little bit. The question that really excites me is, what is the nature of identity on the other side of self-transcendence? So self-transcendence is a concept that probably a lot of us here are familiar with in one way or the other, maybe experiential, maybe just through popular media. And it's a really fascinating topic, but it doesn't really lend itself to any particular opinion about what it is that our self is when we move through the standard paradigm. So I had a friend once who had a sudden epiphany, and he said, "I am the universe." And that's maybe one way of communicating an idea about self-transcendence, but it's not one that will necessarily connect to a lot of people. It's sort of simple, but there's a gap in translation. So how can we start to talk about these ideas of self-transcendence and identity on the other side in a way that actually connects to people universally? So Albert Einstein has this amazing quote about the value of considering this question. He says, "A human being is a part of the whole called by us universe, a part limited in time and space. He experiences himself, his thoughts and feelings, as something separated from the rest, a kind of optical delusion of his consciousness. This delusion is a kind of prison for us, restricting us to our personal desires and to affection for a few persons nearest to us. Our task must be to free ourselves from this prison by widening our circle of compassion to enhance all living creatures and the whole of nature in its beauty." So I grew up in La Jolla, which is a sort of little paradise in San Diego, in Southern California. And for me, it was quite easy to stay in this context with my circle of self relatively small. But I had a sort of nagging sense that there was something more important to discover outside of my circle. And so I sought to extend my boundaries and to connect with the experience of poverty. So when I was in my undergrad, I did what I called a dollar trip. And I took $1 in my pocket and just my clothes. And my mission was to make it on my Vespa from Los Angeles to Las Vegas and back. And in this experience, I connected at a really deep felt level with what it's like to be poor, with what it's like to feel like you have no self-worth, to depend on everybody else completely, to be anxious sleeping in the staircase, that you might be caught by the police, to actually be hassled by the police for begging, and generally to feel very hopeless and without self-worth. So this experience really opened up what I was able to connect to. And over the following years, I traveled all around the world and continued to widen the circle of what I've encompassed in my experiential familiarity. So this topic of connection, I think, is really central to self-transcendence because it is the self that individuates us and in some sense separates us from others. So connection can happen at a couple of different levels. In a very superficial sense, we can feel good about just being acknowledged via Facebook like, or somebody swiping right on Tinder, or through Instagram. At a deeper level, we have a connection of really feeling known. This can happen with family, with friends. We have a more lasting and resilient, robust sense of fullness from this type of connection. Beyond that level of connection, which ultimately will pass, there's a type of connection, in shorthand referred to as interconnectedness, that extends to everything. And when we recognize ourselves as part of an interconnected whole, this transcends our sort of human context, our human framework of thinking, in a way that people like Neil deGrasse Tyson or Carl Sagan so eloquently state. The level that I'm really interested in is beyond beyond that at the level of experience. So interconnectedness typically extends in the realm of matter and energy, at least as we tend to dichotomize it in our own sort of naturally dualistic often minds. But there's a level of experience and connection that applies to our own first personness that we all so intimately have right now. And that's, I think, the level of interbeing. So interbeing is a word that was coined by Thich Nhat Hanh, who's a Buddhist monk, probably familiar with to some extent. He has this quote, to be is to interbe. You cannot just be by yourself alone. You have to interbe with every other thing. So in short, I think we can think of interbeing as interconnectedness and inter-experiencing. Alan Watts says it in a very eloquent way as well. He says, as the ocean waves, the universe peoples. Every individual is an expression of the whole realm of nature, a unique action of the total universe. And I love Alan Watts' statements because he connects to us in such an easy, universal way and gets us to think past this framework of an individualized, separated self. So the level of interbeing is pretty interestingly similar to theory of mind. They both involve a recognition of other minds and the reality of other minds. So we might say, what's the difference? What's the difference between recognizing that everyone here has a mind and being in an interbeing state of identity? So I would ask you to think about theory of mind and the development, which happens typically around 5 years old, and we see it in kindergartners. But we don't really see kindergartners naturally treating each other as equals or sharing or waiting their turn, right? They're pretty selfish little tykes a lot of the time. So there's some way in which just having theory of mind is not sufficient to treat other minds as ontologically equal. And we all ourselves have theory of minds, but if we, in meditation, look into our own experience, we often find we're not actually really treating most other minds as ontologically on the same plane as our own. And if we look at other people, I don't want to get into politics, but there's many ways which we can point fingers and say, people aren't treating minds as ontologically equal. So what is the next step of development beyond the development of theory of mind that will allow this to happen? I think the term theory unifying minds could be a good heuristic. A theory unifying minds, you could say interbeing is one of those theories. And this connects people at the experiential level. And this level of what I think is really helpful to refer to as first personness, as we can so intimately feel it in every moment, our first personness. So my lab team at Columbia is doing research into theory unifying minds and the way that it's becoming a part of our identity, the way that that translates into action and the type of beliefs that are associated with it. And we're interested both in the research side and in the practical applicability in a social sort of revolutionary sort of way. So on the research side, it really has to start with communicating the idea, which is no easy feat. I think I've gone through probably at least 200 renditions of trying to say this and never feel like it comes out quite right. But this is the current state of affairs for the idea of interbeing laid out for scientists. And notably, the language is intended to connect to things at the emerging trends of how we understand things. So everything exists as part of a single connected whole. And everything is made of a single type of substance. This can be understood through multiple different ways, through the Big Bang, the singularity of the Big Bang, the universal applicability of the laws of physics, and quantum field theory. A supporting quote would be, the identicalness of electrons, of all particles, not only cripples the concept of a thing, it's a clue to a kind of holism, an underlying oneness. Or, my thingness is in how I'm organized, not what I'm made of. Secondly, conscious experience is meaningfully organized change within the whole. Separated individual selves or souls do not exist in addition to experience itself. As is succinctly stated in Buddhism, experience exists but not the experiencer. And experience has localized first-personness, which we can all feel is self-evidently true right now, which is a property of the whole, not of separated individual selves. And because first-personness is evidently localized to one place, you right now, and exists in other places at the same time, me right now, for example, it must move from place to place within a single moment. And objections come up here often, and it's in the language of movement. And why do we need movement? So I would say that we do need this term movement, because if we think about first-personness as being localized, as is so self-evidently true for all of us, but we also acknowledge the existence of other minds, we have to think of this property as moving. And you could say that each individual mind has their own first-personness, and therefore just exists everywhere at once, and so it doesn't need to move. But as neuroscience and physics and kind of science in general is showing, these individualized minds carrying first-personness do not exist. So we have to think about first-personness as a property of the whole. And if it's a property of the whole and exists in many locations, but is self-evidently localized into one location, it must move within a single moment of absolute time. So this really starts to invoke two different senses of time. We can think about absolute time as the universal progression from one moment to the next, and horizontal time as the progression of first-personness from one center of experience to the next. The movie I Heart Huckabees captures this beautifully with a quote, "The universe is an infinite sphere whose center is everywhere and circumference is nowhere." So when we take all these points together, the amazing, beautiful conclusion that comes out is that the deepest sense of you exists as all beings in addition to yourself. And the golden rule, treat others as yourself, is inherent to your identity. So this would be just a visualization of self-separation and the kind of initial sense of self that we typically have as self being carried by some individualized entity such as a soul. And this would be a graphic of a sort of idea of interbeing, with first-personness localizing itself through a unitary, uniform fabric, which arises into different what emerge as our experiences of self. And it's quite intriguing to think from this perspective that empathy could be seen as the horizontal equivalent of memory. So memory puts us in touch with a sense of the selves that we have occupied forward and backwards in, we could say, absolute time. In this case, empathy is putting us in touch with the selves that we're occupying along horizontal time. So in the way that you are sensing that I'm here and I'm seeing all of you here and feeling it empathetically, I'm in touch with myself moving through these experiences, as are all of you. So this is quite scientific lingo, and our mission really is to connect to people as whole, to universalize the field of spirituality, and to bridge gaps between science and spirituality for a general population. So we've laid out the idea of interbeing in terms for everyone. So we can say there is one big connected thing made of identical parts, and you are a complex pattern of change within that one thing. Many other yous flow through the thing at once. Each you is experienced individually, one by one. And to acknowledge the perspective of another is to give them their turn, being the special one at the center of experience. And everyone takes their turn in a single moment, and then you get to go again at the next moment. And from this, we see that the deepest you exists as everyone in addition to yourself. And the golden rule, treat others as yourself, is inherent to your true nature. Which is really why we care about this. Getting back to the qualia and the valence, this creates a self-identity that includes a sort of positive feedback loop mechanism into it. I want to create better experiences for you so that as you, I can experience those. And you want to do the same for me. And when we operate from this way, we can create a society, hopefully that's our idea, or the idea that I think religion and many spiritual traditions have been getting at, that we can create these psychological positive feedback loops that can ultimately improve the state of affairs as a whole. So our first attempt to contribute to this process is through the creation of an interbeing scale. And we've conceived of it as separated into dimensions of experience, belief, and behavior, with their subcategories. So here are some examples of the interbeing sample, interbeing items. I've had an experience which shifted my previous understanding that all beings have fundamentally separate selves. I feel as if there is an all-encompassing self that is everyone else while also me. There's no individual self that stays the same over time, only a process of change. A single universe connects all minds, and you are the universe experiencing itself. I have spent many years bringing attention to the oneness of life. I actively consider myself as if I were other people in order to guide my choices. So it's been a really interesting process of trying to create these questions, which are simultaneously trying to be specific, but get at really deep types of concepts that are not easy to capture in a scale. So our preliminary analysis is conducted through MTurk with a sample size of 63. The average completion time is 6 minutes 24 seconds, which is potentially a limitation on interpreting the data. These people are going through these questions really quickly. And 18 failed the attention check. Most of the participants are coming from the US and India. So we conducted an exploratory factor analysis and found that a single component accounted for 41% of the total variance. So we extracted this component as the interbeing component of this scale and correlated it with all of these outcome variables. And really encouragingly and interestingly, we saw that ethical eating, inspiration, purpose, giving, and relationship satisfaction all emerged as very strong correlations. So this is really cool and really encouraging because what we're trying to capture in the scale seems to be emerging in our correlations. We also correlated it with the number of uses of LSD, magic mushrooms, ayahuasca, and MDMA. And I was pretty happy with the results here, seeing that there's correlations with these, which we would suspect to cause these types of identity shifts, perhaps less so with MDMA. So on the revolution side, we're really interested in thinking about how does this actually apply to life? How can we bring it in to actual domains of human endeavors? So this is a sort of listing of a potential idea of life through the interbeing lens. The life outlook that would be implied is quality mattering and the present moment rather than an afterlife being important. In well-being, giving and receiving are both important. In religion, we would be moving towards a non-tribal sort of religion, a universal spirituality in which the cultural differences are really just different approaches at getting at this unitary concept. In business, we could implement it in order to further the already quite popular servant leadership movement and that identifies business as trying to identify and meet legitimate needs of the people. In education, we could focus on identity development and social emotional learning. Artificial intelligence, I think, is a really interesting and really important one, as it's really growing out of our human consciousness. The way that we conceive ourselves, conceive of ourselves, is going to ultimately blossom into the types of consciousnesses and the types of systems that we create. So there's gonna be a really interesting presentation also on the Loving AI project that takes some of this into account. In drug policy, psychedelics would be seen as a tool, and education and harm reduction would be implemented. For integration of those entheogenic experiences, it's a possible framework to use for the grounding and internalization of the entheogenic message. In therapy, we could think about infusing the therapeutic process with interbeing awareness. For social justice, as with my VESPA experiment, we could think about it as a way to encourage empathetic connection with poverty, race, and other types of differences. With end-of-life care, we can think about using it to reduce death anxiety, as already been shown promising with psilocybin experiments, and for grief integration. And with the meat industry, certainly a powerful motivator for creating an ethical overhaul, if we considered those types of experiences that we may be moving through. In art and film, we can think about the opportunity to convey this understanding. Competition's an interesting one. I think it's important, actually. for improving the entire state. Competition is still important, but it's really about a winner and a learner, not so much ego differences between the winner and loser. And in relationships, used as argument reduction, a device to think about how do we transcend our differences, and for accessing what I tend to think of as true love. So, back to the present, right now, right here. It's really important to stay grounded. This is a big perspective, and it can potentially be ungrounding to some. But I don't think there is a need for it to be ungrounding. So on one hand, we have Bruce Hood saying, the daily experience of ourself is so familiar, and yet the brain sciences show that this sense of ourself is an illusion, which can be an ungrounding thing. You're like, oh, I'm not me, like, what? But on the other hand, we have Susan Blackmore, who says, the word illusion does not mean that it does not exist. Rather, an illusion is not what it seems. So it seems to be that we're separate, but we have the opportunity to connect through each other. And I think that understanding that it's not the self is not something that doesn't exist is really important to keep us grounded. So coming out of neuroscience, we're starting to see more and more conclusively that this separate self that we feel is there often is not in there. And as Sam Harris states, we are also making great moral progress, and we will continue to do so. And I think that these really have a reciprocal interaction with each other in the way that when we transcend this separate self into a framework of interbeing, a theory unifying minds, that's a very strong motivator for moral progress. So I'd like to show this 1 minute clip from a movie called Living on a Dollar. I just saw this recently and I was struck. It's like, wow, there's a couple college guys and they go out and they try to live on a dollar a day to connect to poverty. And in doing that in Guatemala, they find this man who basically extends his self in an amazing way by seeing himself in another. And he's a local Guatemalan man.
Like about how close this community was, and we hang out with Chino every day, and his mom this past year got really sick, and they don't even have enough money to, you know, to get a car to go to the hospital in town, and Anthony covered the entire thing.
Victor llegó a mi casa y me decía, es que mi esposa está enferma, yo no tengo dinero. Entonces me dice, y si no encuentro dinero, mi esposa se va a morir.
And Anthony actually paid for them to go to the hospital. He paid for the doctor's visits
and the medicine.
And the medicine.
Anthony can afford the loan because he's the only one in the village who has a formal job. Unlike everyone else, he can count on getting a regular paycheck.
Yo cuando di dinero a la familia de Chino, veo la necesidad que tiene porque yo miro a Chino como que si fuera yo mismo.
So I think it's amazingly touching and powerful to see the type of difference that one person can make in Guatemala with the type of resources that they have through this perspective. And to think about the amount of power and potential to really motivate ourselves to create a better society that we could create through collaboratively accessing this type of identity. And so to wrap it up, as you move through your day and the following weeks, I would encourage you to ask yourself this question: how could I use the lens of inner being to improve my life right now? And when I've asked myself this question, I usually tend to smile and look at other people and think about how I can give to them, how I can forgive, how I can connect, and how I can really live. And so with that, I would like to thank my amazing lab team, Sophie Whitney, Kendra Terry, Sean Grark, Angel Hu, Ryan McCauley, Brendan Kravatin, Simon Troy, and my advisor, Dr. Miller. And we have a website if you want to look a little more into it, and this is the website from the Living on $1. And thank you.